many of the industries are looking into to work or work or creating the projects on the blockchain. But without understanding, it is difficult to get success in blockchain area. You can see this cartoon. Here, the boss of the one of the companies is asking, where should we focus in this year? So obviously, people will talk about the blockchain. So this is the current hype. So that manager is saying that we'll work on blockchain area. Then boss will ask, why? Manager is saying that it will change everything. What it will change, that manager is not me, because he has heard about the blockchain from somewhere else. Then he's saying that everybody talking about it. It has potential applications which are endless, and we do not want to be left behind, because he's knowing that other companies are also trying to explore the blockchain. Then at the end, boss has asked, what exactly is blockchain? Manager is aware about the recent technologies like cloud computing, AI, and other things. So he said it is artificial intelligence. So this is vague answer. So without understanding of blockchain, everyone is trying to jump into the blockchain. But first of all, we should understand the fundamentals of blockchain. So these three sessions are on understanding the blockchain, that how it is working, what will be the capacity of the blockchain, where we should apply, where we should not consider the blockchain. So there are a lot of things in the basics of the blockchain which we'll see in these three sessions. If you see in this cartoon, why many of the industries are trying to get into the blockchain, the answers are already given. Because if you see this, manager has already understood that it will change everything. What it will change? Because manager is not going to look forward for the legacy application. You do not want to use the legacy application. So he wants to change something. And he understood that blockchain will change everything without knowing what it will change. Then second reason is saying that everyone is talking about it. So everyone is talking about it means this is the blockchain hype. So that is why he wants to work on the blockchain. Second, the third thing is, he's saying the potential applications are endless without knowing which are the applications. And this is the most obvious reason where due to what many industries are jumping into the blockchain, that we do not want to be left behind. Means this is kind of competition. Every IT industry will look forward to get into the competition with each other. And they want to explore the new and new technology, and that is why they are trying to jump into the blockchain. So from the historical perspective, the cryptocurrency and consensus were considered from 1983. If you see the game theory, consensus means what? It is kind of game theory that we have a set of people and we want to do final decision on some particular event. So this final decision how to make, because in this network or in this group of people, they are not trusting to each other. So obviously we have to play some game theory, and using game theory, we have to come up with the final decision. So such methods are already developed from 1983, and cryptocurrency kind of digital cash was also considered from 1983. Then early cryptocurrency systems came from 1989. But when this Satoshi Nakamoto's paper came into picture, from that the way of looking into cryptocurrency changed. And this was the birth of the today's blockchain. So this was the Bitcoin white paper. Then after that, open source release and deployment of such blocks, Bitcoin was started. Then it has gained the wide acceptance and it was making the news. After that, from 2011, if you see that it was explored heavily and it was growing in exponential way, I can say. So this was the rapid extension of the Bitcoin in this era. From 2011 to still it is going high. And then people have come up with the blockchain. Now nobody talking about Bitcoin, but they are talking about the blockchain. And they are understanding Bitcoin is the blockchain. No, blockchain is a technology or we can say that merger of the our IT area. So how it is different from the traditional? So we know that blockchain is. So we can say that this is the database. On the top of, we are putting some rules to store the data. Then it cannot complete with some other's data that is already in the database. Means we have to consider the consistency of the data. It should append only. Means once data are written, it should not be modified. Means it should have only append only feature. But in case of normal database, you can have read, you can write, or you can have modify permission with some access control. But blockchain, when people have such requirement that the database should have only append only feature, means once data written into database, it should not be modified. And data itself is locked to owner, means owner is the sole entity to write the data or to read that data, and replicable and available, means data should be available every time, and replicable means instead of creating a one copy in normal database or in central database, the data should be replicated among the number of nodes so that it will be available or it can be retrieved from any of the node. So these are the requirements were put over the normal database management system, and that was the birth of the blockchain. So in this case, everyone agrees on what the state of thing in the database are canonical without the central party. So without the use of central party, the state of database is considered. So these requirements were, or these are the requirements were put on the normal database, and that has given the birth of the blockchain. So this is the difference between our databases and blockchain. So databases were on the on-premise database, virtual machines or cloud. It was using the Web 2.0 centralization. So this database, earlier we can say that databases are the like centralization architectures, declarative procedure, data management indexes. So whatever query we are performing over the database, such kind of queries are there. But what it is making the difference from the blockchain? In blockchain, we are doing the state management. That once data is loaded, then before storing the data, its state should be maintained. Self-sovereign identity, security, and cryptographic schemes are involved into the blockchains to offer the requirements which I have covered here. This requirement, to fulfill these requirements, these are the properties. These are the methods are involved. The smart contract. So what is the common between databases and blockchain? Data should be verifiable. In centralized database, it is difficult to verify. In blockchain, it is easy to verify the data. Then before writing the data, there should be some consensus. Then privacy, user privacy should be there. Side chains. So we can say that our normal database is kind of side chain to load data on the public blockchain. Then it should have validators. So validators are available in both the cases. Before storing the data into the database or blockchain, validators are there. But the validation procedure is different in databases and in blockchains. Then incentivization. Incentivization I will cover later. Incentivization should be relevant to the cost of putting the data. If the cost of writing the data is high, then it is very difficult to give the incentives, because people will go for the centralized database. If the cost of writing the data in the database is high, then people will go for the centralized database. Then security tokens. So security tokens are kind of access control and other security measures can be involved in both the blockchains and the databases. In case of traditional data transfer, suppose consider this is a sender, this is a receiver. So the data may pass from the multiple intermediaries, like from one bank to the another, another bank to the second bank, third bank, fourth bank, so on. So data will pass from the multiple intermediaries. But in blockchain-based transfer, we need not to rely on multiple intermediaries. There is a centralized entity that is called blockchain. So blockchain will maintain the data. But how blockchain will maintain the data? Again, it is a peer-to-peer network. So all the nodes will maintain data. So without the use of intermediaries, you can directly transfer your data from origin to the destination. So consider, we have seen that blockchain maintains a log of all the transactions since the start of the deployment. Like for example, in Bitcoin, there is no direct record of the current state. But if you see the distributed database and blockchain, trust model is fundamentally different. This is your distributed database environment that all the nodes are having the copy of database. But here we have to consider that nodes are A to D are having the trust among each other. So they are thinking that we trust each other and everyone is maintaining the copy of data. So they are against the outsiders, means if external user is there, apart from this node A to D, if external user is there, then he should have access control and data validation, because he will not trust on these four nodes. So data validation from external user is required, and for accessing this data from any of these database, he will require the access control. So the trust boundary is within this network. Trust boundary is among these nodes only. It is not going beyond this node. But in case of blockchain, trust boundary is within that particular node, not in the network, because here nodes are not trusting to each other. So trust boundary is within that particular node. Means whenever node B or though any node is receiving the data, he will think that don't send data indiscriminately, verify everything what you are receiving. So every entity, we can say that they are not trusting on each other. Whatever they are receiving, they must have to verify, and after verification, they have to put that data into their database. In case of distributed database, if node is sending data to B and node B trusting on A, so node B will store the copy of that data to the node B's database. But in case here, if node is A is sending data to node B is not trusting on node A. So node B will first verify whether this data is genuine or not. If that data is genuine, or if that data are verified, then node B will update its own database. But here, in distributed database, data updation will be based on the trust among these nodes. In case of blockchain, there is no trust among the entities. So if you have such application where there is no trust among the entities in your network, then you can better go for the blockchain. Another thing that, as I said, that this is peer-to-peer network. So consider these are four peers into the blockchain network. So what your data, they are verifying based on the consensus among them, the data will be added to the blockchain, and this blockchain will be replicated to the each and every node. Now, P4 is getting this blockchain record from the P2, but P4 will verify whether this block two is verified or not, and that block two is verified based on the consensus mechanism. So again, it is leading to the trust factor that P1 to P4 are not trusting on each other. Before writing data on their own storage, they are running the consensus, and then only they are writing data to their node. So in traditional database, we need some issues, but these are the issues to fulfill the requirements of the blockchain. First of all, development is quicker and slower in case of blockchain. Means creating a provably consistent system is not easy task. as we have seen that all the nodes are maintaining the copy of database. Now think about, there is a small bug in some of the nodes or in few of the nodes. So if that bug will affect the data, so consistency among all the nodes data will not be there. So it is very strict to maintain this consistency among all the nodes, and to maintain the consistency, if that blockchain will be slower than the centralized database. It is easy to store the data on centralized database and you can maintain the consistency. But blockchain is the kind of distributed database, that database copy is replicated to all the nodes, and all the nodes will have to maintain the consistency of that data. So that is why it is slower. Second thing is, incentive structures are difficult to design. Think about, I want to use blockchain, I want to store my data, but if the cost of storing that data is high, the cost in the sense it will have thousands of transactions of the same data. In blockchain, consider there are thousands of nodes. So every node should have to verify, validate the transaction, and the cost of doing this process will be thousands times than the cost of storing data on this centralized database. So that is why it is difficult to create the incentive structure. Maintenance is also very costly. Maintaining the one database, the cost of maintaining the one database will be cheaper than cost of maintaining the data.
Hello. Sir, you are not audible. Hello. Hello. Chirag sir, are you there?
सर नो नंबर वाली कार्ड को फोन करो
हेलो
यस वी आर ट्राइंग टू कांटेक्ट चिराग सर जस्ट वेट फॉर 2 मिनट्स
नथिंग इट्स अ नेटवर्क इशू
यस आई थिंक सो Hello, Chirag sir, we are not able to listen anything. Hello.
Yes,
yes sir.
Hello, can you hear me now?
Yes.
Yeah. So there are some issues. There are such issues into the blockchain. Then the question is why industries are moving forward for the blockchain. I already given the answer of this question in my first slide of that cartoon slide. The first answer is industries are using the legacy software system to maintain their database. Like for the supply chain management, they are using the legacy system. In such legacy system, the maintenance cost is very high. So that is why industries are moving forward. Instead of putting lot of money over the maintenance, they are planning to go for the new technology. Second answer is many of the current organization, they do not want to rely on centralized control. As we are using the term trusted third party. But in this world, it is very difficult to find out the trusted third party. Although we are putting agreement with the third party, but again, that third party may be the partially malicious or maybe fully dishonest that party. So they do not want to give all the control data to the third party, and that is why they are planning to go for the decentralization of the system. Third answer is that why industries are moving forward for the blockchain it is considered as a leading edge technology because now it blockchain has got the hype, so they are planning to go for the blockchain. So these are the answers for that. So blockchain, if you want, really would like to develop your blockchain, the blockchain is the merger of this era. So this area should be known to everyone to learn about the blockchain. The first is the database, because blockchain, I can say that the rules it is deploying over the database, and that is the birth of the blockchain. So you should understand the properties of database. Second thing, it is having the peer-to-peer network. So your you should have the fundamental knowledge of the computer network. So how you can connect the data nodes, how you can transmit the data. Third thing is the cryptography, because here the security term is that data should be secure. Data should be written into the distributed database in such a way that everyone should agree on that data, but nobody trusting on each other. So for that, we need the game theory. And all these things are, this whole technology based on the software base. So we require the software engineering terms. Again, So on the top of blockchain, you can consider other areas like IoT, blockchain, IoT, cloud. I can say that it is giving data to the blockchain. It is kind of feeding technology to the blockchain. Cloud computing are such other areas you can consider to give the sufficient power to the blockchain, because cloud computing can give the sufficient storage space. Cloud computing can give the sufficient processing power to enable the blockchain. These are the key features of the blockchain. Some of the features you are already knowing, that blockchain is offering security to data. Means once data are loaded, then the data will not be modified. Security in the sense of validation of the data. Then it is offering the immutability features, because it is having the append only data feature. transparency that once data are loaded over blockchain, it can be seen by everyone. So it is giving the read-only features to the users. Tracing of the data you can do. It is having full decentralization. It is establishing the trust among the untrusted entities that we have already seen. Anonymity of the users is also there. So anonymity of the users are achieved using the pseudo identity of the users, like in the case of the banking system, that whatever transactions you are performing, that you are performing through your account ID. Using your account ID, nobody can identify who you are. So similarly, in case of blockchain also, you are having kind of wallet address. Through wallet address, you will be known. But it is providing the user anonymity, means using your wallet address, it is difficult to map your identity. So the birth of blockchain, we can say that when Bitcoin came into picture, from that onwards, people have started exploring the blockchain, underlying blockchain technology, and they have explored the various other projects. So why that was the Bitcoin was required? Because transaction system needed to be decentralized, transparent, and incorruptible. The way that earlier transaction system was doing that, they were having the centralized system and everyone has to trust on the centralized system. And due to that, because it is causing the trust factor. So digital currency allows for the instantaneous transactions and borderless transfer of the ownership. And that was difficult to achieve through the centralized system. And the Bitcoin white paper was proposed on 31st October 2018 by Satoshi Nakamoto. And that paper had changed the way of performing the digital transactions. So this paper is saying that blockchain is a like purely peer-to-peer electronics cash or digital asset transfer system, but that is the Bitcoin definition. And that was considered as the first popular implementation of the blockchain, and this is birthing today's blockchain industry. So I am not saying that Bitcoin is the blockchain. Blockchain is the underlying technology of the Bitcoin. So Bitcoin is one of the application of the blockchain. And after that, additional blockchains have been popularized, like you know these blockchains like Ethereum, Hyperledger, IOTA, Ripple, Coda, so many other projects. But the concept behind all these blockchains are same, means they want to achieve these features over the traditional database, but their architectures are different. So there is no standard definition, but we can define blockchain like it is a distributed database, that we have already seen that every node is maintaining the copy of the data. And this database is practically immutable. Even if I am having that copy of database, if I want to modify data, I cannot modify. Because if I will modify, it will not reflect to the other's copy. So my data will not be considered. So that is practically immutable. Another thing, This practically immutable feature is offered through the cryptographically back referencing of block. So if you are trying to break this link, it is difficult to order and validate the transaction. And that is why it is considered as practically immutable. And blockchain is maintained by the decentralized peer-to-peer network using the consensus mechanisms. Means when every node will update their record, through this consensus mechanism, if that data is validated or verified, then everyone will update their record. So this is the common workflow of the blockchain. Like let's say this is the transaction initiator and this is the receiver. So if I want to perform transaction, I'll publish in a peer-to-peer network that this transaction I want to perform. So I'm sending some data. So transaction can be your token or any of the data, or digital data. So every node will wait for such transaction request. So whenever these nodes will get some certain amount of the transaction request, they will start mining the block. The mining process I will cover later. So consider that one of the node has mined that block. Mined that block means that one of the node has created that block and saying that my block is valid. Means whatever data I have generated, this data are valid. Then other nodes will verify that whatever this node is claiming, whether it is correct or not. So other nodes will verify whether this block is correct or not. If that block is correct, then it will be reflected into blockchain. So means once that block is correct, means once like certain amount of confirmation will come that this block is correct, then every other nodes will update their copy of the blockchain. So this is the common workflow of the blockchain. Now we'll see the building block structure. So as I said that every node will wait for the certain amount of transactions. Once that certain amount of transaction will come, then every node will try to mine that block, or mine block means creating a block. So they will put transaction list here. So a block, it consists of a block header and transaction list. So transaction list is here. And the block header part is here. So the building block of blockchain or block is the magic number, means which is showing the which network you are operating, what is the starting of this block. So that is offered by the magic number. Block size is defining the size of this whole block. Version, as there is no interoperability among the blockchain platforms, so every node has to, the sender and receiver or every node should be operate on same version of the blockchain. This is previous block S value. This Merkle root, the transactions are ordered in the terms in the form of Merkle tree. I will cover what is Merkle tree, that I will cover later. And the root of this Merkle tree will be stored in the header. Then timestamp, which is showing the at what time this block is generated, difficulty target, that will be that is a part of the consensus, and the nonce value. Now if you see all these parameters, which parameter can be modified? Magic number you cannot modify because that is showing the network and start of the block. Block size you cannot modify. Version you cannot modify. Previous block S value you cannot modify. Merkle root you cannot, because that is dependent on this. Timestamp you cannot modify. Difficulty target you cannot. You can modify only nonce value. Means you can modify nonce value. You have to modify this nonce value in such a way that the overall hash of this block should be lower than the previous block S value. That is the criteria for mining the block. Means I have to calculate the S, suppose I am taking nonce value 0, then I will calculate the S value of this block. If that S value is lower than the previous block S value, then I can say that I am successful. So like this, every node in the blockchain or in the peer-to-peer network, they will perform this, they will update the nonce value and they will perform. They will find out the S value of this block. If that block is having the S value lower than the previous block S value, then this block should be added into the blockchain after the confirmation of the other nodes. Now the beauty of hash function, it is very easy to calculate the hash value from the given data, but it is very difficult to calculate the hash value as a target hash value. That is the beauty of hash, and that is why every node has to put their enough computational power to be successful. Means they have to mine the block before the others, so that they can broadcast that I am the successful and I have mined this block. And other nodes can just verify whether this S value for this nonce value, whether this block is correct or not, whether this block is validated or not. Then it will be added into the blockchain. Now the question is, why transaction list is recorded in the form of Merkle tree? If I'll put transaction in serial order, not in the form of Merkle tree, then here I have to calculate the S value for all the transactions. Instead of that, I can put only the root of these transactions. So these transactions are ordered in the form of tree, and I will put the root value into this block. So this will be the easier task. And that is why Merkle tree or Merkle root is considered here. So these are the building blocks of blockchain. So magic number is the identifier of the blockchain network, which indicates the start of the block and data is from which network. Block size, it is fixed to the 1 MB, but however, it can be increased to the 2 MB, maximum capacity 2 GB, and still people are looking for. So if I am having the less size of that block, I can put small number of the transactions. If I can increase the size of that block, I can put more number of transactions. So like, let's say that 1 MB, within 1 MB, suppose if I am able to put only 6 transactions, if I am increase it to the 2 MB, I can put the 12 transactions. Means each node must have to wait for the 12 transactions, and then only they can start mining the block. But in that case, if I'm increasing the size, then that node have to wait for more time. So it will slow down that process of putting the transaction into the blockchain. Version, each node has to implement same version of the blockchain because there is interoperability issue. Timestamp, difficulty, target, and nonce value, this will be required for calculating the hash value. This will be required for calculating the hash value of this current block in such a way that this block's S value will be lower than the previous block S value. It is using the SHA-256 S function and Merkle tree. So this we'll see later in the depth that how SHA-256 is working. It is using the elliptic curve digital signature algorithm to generate the public private key pairs of the user. And also it is used for digitally sign the data and to sign the S function. So this we'll see later. It is building blocks of the blockchain can include the nodes and peer. It requires the consensus to write the data into blockchain. It requires the wallet. It requires the smart contract, but smart contracts are the optional. So this is the blockchain structure. So as I said, that blocks are linked to each other, and this linking, logical linking, is offered in such a way that the block of the S of the current block should be lower than the previous block's S value. So through this logical linking, they are connected to each other. So it is kind of linked list, but linked list is offered by the S value. This is the Merkle tree of the transactions. So let's say there are 4 transactions. And for each transaction, I have to calculate the S value. Again, I will calculate the S of these S values, and I will reach to the root value. And this root value will be appended or will be added into the block header. So even if the beauty of hash function, even if I'm changing the one bit of the data, then whole S value will be changed. So if I'm changing one of the bit of this data, the whole block's S value will it may not be lower than the previous block S value. So this is how you cannot modify data once it is added to the blockchain. So this is the reference architecture of the blockchain. If you would like to develop any application, you should consider such kind of architecture. So at the bottom part, you will obviously have blockchain network. So where you will have multiple nodes, and every node will maintain the copy of the data. It can be in the form of transactions or it can be in the form of blocks. On the top of a distributed ledger or this blockchain network, it will have integration of using the cloud services, inter contract messaging. So like I'm having contract, I want to perform messaging among the contracts. So this is the middle layer between the blockchain network and smart contracts. It can have IoT devices which can push data either to the smart contract or directly to the blockchain network. On the top of that, smart contracts are there. I will cover detail smart contracts in detail later. But smart contract considered as a kind of software code, which should be created before submitting data to the blockchain. So this contract or this code should be called, or we can say it is a function which should be called before pushing data to the blockchain. On the top of contract, you can have applications. So there are many applications of the blockchain. And vertically, we have to offer the security, like certification authority required to produce our digital certificates, policies, access control, identity management, and crypto systems are required. So this is kind of reference architecture of the blockchain. Now the question is how blockchain is offering the immutability feature. So consider these three blocks are already generated into the blockchain, and the copy of these three blocks are already reflected among these nodes. Now there is a client one and client two. Now they want to add the block three, but if they are adding block three into their node, like client one is adding block three into this node, means P1, client two is adding block three at this node, but this will not be reflected to the P2 and P4, because they can update their copy, but these copies should be reflected at P2 and P4. And for that, we need some consensus. Let's say without consensus, they cannot put this block three. So that how that consensus can work, that it can have many game theory option before replicating data to all the nodes. So let's say we'll see the Benjatine general. It was devised in 1982. As I said, that this consensus and cryptocurrencies were started from 1982, but these were now emerged with the blockchain. These things are emerged with the blockchain. So like take the example, one process like commander process, which is having the initial value either to attack or retreat when they are into the war. Other processes like left-handed processes, they will communicate the commander value to the other people. They will communicate the value of a commander with the other people. Now malicious processes can lie about the value. Means malicious left-handed can lie about the value. So this can be faulty value, and correct processes will report the truth that whatever commander is giving command, that will be, that is communicated. So in this case, either commander, in case of malicious value, either commander or left-handed may be faulty. Now the consensus means if the commander is correct, if the commander is correct, then correct processes will agree on the commander's process value. Means at least correct processes will agree on the commander processes. If commander is faulty, then all the processes will give any value. Means all the left-handed processes will give any value. That means it is showing that at least 2/3 of the network should behave honestly. Means when commander is correct, then at least there should be some 2/3 of network correct processes should agree on the commander's value. Otherwise they will update their wrong data. So same you can apply here, that if client one is saying that I have updated this data, and if this 2/3 of network is saying that this data is correct, then others will update this copy. Otherwise, this copy will not be updated. This is what Benjatine fault tolerance system. Now security through the transparency, as we have seen that blockchain is offering security and as well as transparency. Let's say this, I can say that birthday cake example. Consider this kid is having birthday today. And at evening, this kid's mother would like to celebrate, but this cake is brought in the morning. So you know that kids will be very eager to eat this cake. But a mother will wait for till evening so that this cake should be eaten, or this kid's birthday should be celebrated in evening. So how that mother can secure that cake? How to secure that cake? Either you can put this cake into the cupboard and you can lock it so that your kid cannot take this cake. Means this is what security. Means you are encrypting data. You are encrypting data so that others cannot modify that data. But instead of this, if I'm putting this cake on table and I'm asking to look at this cake that nobody should eat, then this kid will not dare to eat this cake because everyone is looking into it. So this is what transparency. Data is transparent to all. Means the copy of data is available to all the nodes, but nobody trying to modify that data because they know that others are looking into that data also. This is what security through transparency is offered by the blockchain. Now we'll see the cryptographic uses in blockchain. So cryptography, from cryptography, S function and elliptic curve cryptography used for the blockchain construction. So cryptography is used for the initiation of the transaction and broadcasting of the transaction. So when you are initiating and broadcasting the transaction should be digitally signed so that the nodes into the peer-to-peer network, they can verify that from where this transaction is coming. So it will help to achieve the non-repudiation as well as the authenticity of the transaction. Second, it is required for validation of the transaction. Validation of the transaction as well as the block. So it is based on the proof of work and certain alternatives, means certain other consensus mechanisms. So based on these blocks will, you know that these blocks are going to be added into the blockchain. But this process will require the cryptographic term. So here also hash function is going to be used. Here digital signature and public private key pairs will be generated using the elliptic curve cryptography. And chaining of blocks will be done using the S function. So wallet creation and signing of the transaction, for that will require the keys, and how those keys will be generated using the elliptic curve cryptography. And signing the transactions will require the elliptic curve based digital signature algorithm. So how it is working? So whenever you are downloading the software of wallet, you have to provide your identity. But you know that to perform the transaction, your identity should not be revealed. Blockchain need to provide the anonymity of the user. So this wallet, the software will generate the pseudo random number. Once you will provide the identity, based on the identity, this may be the seed value. So using that seed value, the wallet will generate the pseudo random number. And from that random number, it will take the initial 80 bytes of the random number and it will apply the SHA-256 S algorithm. Means it will generate the, from the given pseudo random number, it will generate the 256 bit S value. Now from this 256 bit S value, I'll cover how that 256 S function is working. Now from the given this 256 bit S value, first 4 bytes of S value will be added at the end of this random number, and that will be converted into the base 28 string, and this is called as your wallet import format private key. Means this key should not be revealed, because using this key you are going to generate your wallet address kind of public key, and that should be known to everyone. So how that public key will be generated? To produce the public key, consider that wallet import format private key is K, and G is a generator point on the elliptic curve, because we need to generate the public key using the elliptic curve. So we must have to select a one point over the elliptic curve, and that point will be multiplied with this private key, and that will be the public key. Now the requirement of the public private key pair generation is, from a given private key, it should be very easy to generate the public key. But from the given public key, it should be impossible to, or it should be very difficult to generate the private key. Now you see here, using the private key and the generator point, we have derived the public key. Whether this requirement will be fulfilled, So if I know this public key, if I know this point P, can I derive this private key? No, because we have used the elliptic curve cryptography here. And this is not our normal arithmetic multiplication. This is scalar multiplication. And that is why it is causing the discrete logarithm problem. So these things I will cover later, that how it is very difficult. Once this public key will be generated, it will be S using the SAR256 algorithm, and the resultant output is again S using the RIPMD 160-bit algorithm. So at the end, it will generate the 160-bit public key. And this output will be converted into the binary value, and that is your unique address. So if I want to perform transaction with you, I know only your unique address. So using your unique address, I can perform transactions with you. And this is like your anonymous, pseudo anonymous ID, kind of our account number to perform transactions with the centralized banking authority. So now we'll see that how elliptic curve cryptography is working. So elliptic curve cryptography was proposed in 1985, but it was standardized in 1990s. And it is mainly used in the resource constrained environment. Why? Because it requires the less processing power and less key size as compared to the RSA to offer same security level. So as the computer power evolves, the key size of the conventional system is required to be increased dramatically. So if you see that the computational power is evolved, so nowadays RSAs, I can say that if I am using the RSA, the less key size will not give me the sufficient security. So I must have to increase the size of key. But if I am increasing the size of key in case of RSA, it will take more computational effort. So why I cannot use the less size of ECC, which is offering same security level as the RSA, so that I can reduce the number of computation while encrypting the data or while performing the digital signature. So this elliptic curve cryptography is standardized by many organizations. So we'll see that how elliptic curve cryptography is working. So elliptic curves are not the ellipses or not the circles. So circle equation can be given by x square plus y square plus I is equal to r square. Ellipses are given by the ax square plus by square is equal to c. Elliptic curves are defined by the y square x cube plus ax plus b, where a and b are the variables. So if you change this a and b, you can have different kinds of curve. So this is the sample curve. With the different values of a and b, you can produce different kinds of curve. So the scope of generating the key, or there you can have the infinite number of curves while by changing the values of a and b. So we'll see that, because we know that to generate the public key, we have to perform the scalar multiplication of private key and the point over elliptic curve. So we'll see the some operations over the elliptic curve. Suppose if I want to add the two points over the elliptic curve, let's say P and Q. So this is geometric approach. So consider these are the two points over the elliptic curve which I want to add. So these P and Q are the points over elliptic curve. I'll draw a line intersecting P and Q, so which will again intersect on third point on that elliptic curve. So that is the minus R. From that point, I'll draw a vertical line, so which will again intersect to the one of fourth point on that elliptic curve. And this point R is the addition of P plus Q. And as this curve is having the symmetry over x-axis, so if I want to perform the point negation, then I have to just draw a vertical line, and while drawing vertical line, wherever, at whatever point this line is intersecting the curve, that point is called as the negation of the given point. We are more interested over the multiplication. So if I want to, if I'm performing KP, so I can go from 1P, 2P, 2P to the 3P, means I'm adding that point one by one, P plus P plus P. Like this, I have to perform KP. So if I'm moving from P2 to the 2P, so means what? That point is added two times. So here, consider this is one point P. I want to perform R equal to 2P. So I have to draw a line, a tangent line, which is passing from this point P, which will intersect on one point over the tangent curve, that is my minus R. I will draw a vertical line, which will again intersect on point over elliptic curve, that is R. This R is equal to the 2P. Now I want to perform this is 2P. I want to perform 4P. Again, I will draw a line, which is a tangent line from this point R, which will again intersect on third point. And then I will draw a vertical line. Around here, I will get the 4P. Then I can go for 5P, 6P. So that is why this is called as scalar multiplication. And the point which is intersecting the x-axis, that point is called as point of origin, because this curve is having the symmetry over the x-axis. This is the algebraic approach. So here x and y are defined by the coordinates, because this all the points over elliptic curve are defined by the two coordinates x and y. So if I want to perform the point addition P plus Q, which is R, so I will first calculate the S, which is the, I can say that Y coordinate of P minus Y coordinate of Q divided by X coordinate of P minus X coordinate of Q. And then the X coordinate of my result will be the S square minus X coordinate of P minus X coordinate of Q. And y coordinate of result will be the minus y coordinate of P plus S into x coordinate of P minus x coordinate of R. This should be not R, this should be Q. This should be Q. So this is how I can, using the algebraic approach, I can perform the elliptic point addition over the elliptic curve. So if you are building your own libraries over elliptic curve, you can consider this. Point doubling is also done, can be done using this algebraic approach. So elliptic curves are used to construct the public key crypto system, cryptographic system. Consider your private key D is randomly selected from one field 1 to n minus 1. Then the public key Q is computed by performing the scalar multiplication of private key and that point over elliptic curve, that is P. So this P and Q are the points on elliptic curve where Q will be the public key and D will be the private key. So like the conventional system, once you can have public private key pair, you can generate derive the variety of crypto systems like signature generation, verification, encryption, decryption. You can perform the key management also if you are able to derive public private key pair by fulfilling the criteria of the public private key. Then you can develop any crypto systems. So computing DP denoted as scalar multiplication. And it is not only used for the computation of public key, but also it can be used for the signature, encryption, and key agreement in the elliptic curve cryptography system. So as in a blockchain, we are using only elliptic curve-based digital signature algorithm. So I'll cover only elliptic curve-based digital signature algorithm. For key management, elliptic curve-based DeFi-Hellman protocol is also available, but which I am not covering. So how that signature algorithm is working? So first of all, we have to generate the public private key pair. So if entity would like to communicate with entity B, so entity A need to generate the public private key pair. Using the private key, entity A will generate the signature of a given message, and entity B will verify using the public key of the entity A. That is the standard, I can say, that concept of the signature generation and verification. So entity A selects the one curve, elliptic curve, over the ZP. And the number of points are defined in the EZP, which should be divisible by large prime number. Why this order of I is considered? Suppose, let's say I'm not considering the order of I. then the computing D from the given Q and P is called a discrete logarithm problem. But an attacker, if he knowing this Q and P over this elliptic curve, he can apply this value D randomly, means he can increment value of D every time at any of the, at one moment he will be successful for that D. So this brute force attack can be possible, and that is why the order of I is considered. Then A will select the unique and unpredictable random integer D, that is the private key of A, and the computing the public key from the given private key will be the Q is equal to DP, where Q is the public key of the entity A. So A's public key will be that curve which is selected, A's public key will be the curve which is selected by entity A. The point which is chosen to calculate the public key, I, which modulus operation or which order is considered, that I is considered, and the Q, that is the public key. So these four components are the part of public key, and A's private key the D. So how that signature is generated? So A will select the unique and unpredictable integer K. So it is same as like the Algmal signature scheme. So A will select the unique integer K in the interval 1 to I minus 1, because whatever operations we are performing into this modulus field 1 to I minus 1. Then A will compute KP. So this P is the point over elliptic curve. So KP will give you the two coordinates, because KP will be the another point over the elliptic curve. So which will have two coordinates, X and Y. Then A will compute the R is equal to X mod I. To avoid the security condition, R should not be equal to 0. If R is equal to 0, then you have to choose some other value of K. If R is not equal to 0, then you have to calculate the S. S will be the K inverse. The whatever K you have chosen here, the K inverse S of the message plus the D, the private key of this entity A, and the R, which is calculated in this second step, mod N, where H is the secure S algorithm, maybe SHA-1 or SHA-256 you can use. So if S is equal to 0, again you have to choose the different value of K. So this R and S, if you see here, while calculating the S, the message is also used to generate the signature component and the private key. So S is having your message as well as your private key. While R and S are the two components or two signature components of the given message M. Now, how that signature verification will take place? Consider entity B is having the public key of the A. Is having the public key of A, which is elliptic curve. The point which was chosen to generate this public key, that is P, I the modulus number, public key of A. So first of all, whenever B is receiving that signature, it should be within this modulus field. Because if the signature is modified, it may not be within this modulus field. So first of all, verify if R and S are in this modulus field or not. If R and S are in the modulus field, then the compute W is equal to, compute one variable W is equal to S inverse. S is your signature component, S inverse mod I. And message already you have received. So message S will be calculated. Now from this, you have to compute two variables, U1 and U2. U1 is the S of the message into this W mod I, where U2 will be the signature component R into this calculated W mod I. Then compute U1 into this P, point over elliptic curve, plus U2 into Q. These two are the numerical value, and P and Q are the point over elliptic curves. P is the point over elliptic curve, and Q is also a point over elliptic curve, which is your public key. So when you are performing these operations, it will give you the two coordinates, x0 and y0. If this V calculated V, if this calculated V, V is calculated using the x0 mod I. If this V is equal to R, then the signature is accepted. Otherwise, either message is modified or signature is modified. That is what consider. So what is the security strength? The security strength of elliptic curve is based on the inverse of the point multiplication. And that is called a discrete logarithm problem. Means point multiplication you are doing for deriving the public key. So public key Q is equal to KP, where K is the integer and P is the point over elliptic curve. Now the security strength means it is based on the discrete logarithm problem. What it is saying? Given Q and P, it should be difficult to find out this K. And that is what inverse of point multiplication. So given point P and Q, find a number K such that KP is equal to Q. You can apply brute force attack here. You can change the value of K every time and you can get it. But we have applied the modulus and we are defining this curve over the field. And that is why this brute force attack cannot be possible. So P is the base point on specific curve, Q is the public key and K is the private key, which can be very large prime number. With doubling, you can go from P to 2P. With addition, you can go for 2P to the 3P. So determining the KP in this way is referred to as a scalar multiplication of point. And scalar multiplication is intractable. If you have normal arithmetic, means if these P and Q are not the points, but these are the values only, then deriving K from the given P and Q, Q is very trivial task. So K is the discrete logarithm of Q to the base P. So brute force attack ranges up to 3×10^57 operations by stepping a process. So there is a method to solve this problem, which is Pollard-Rowe method. Using that you can solve, but it requires lot of operations, which applies to the NIST P192 curve. So implementation allows for a significant reduction in key size. Why elliptic curve is widely used for such application? Even if you see the SSL TLS version 1.3, they are trying to replace the RSA with the ECC. Why? Because it requires the less key size compared to the RSA to offer the same security level. So ECC key of 163 bit is equivalent to the RSA key of 1024 bits. And ECC key of 256 bit is equivalent to the RSA key of 3072 bits. And that is why, so as the key size is less, it requires the less computational. And if it requires less computational, it requires less energy also from the devices. So the advantages of elliptic curve is like it requires smaller key size faster than the RSA, so that it can be used for the Android or cell phone devices. Means such devices, means it can be used for the resource constraint environment, like your wireless sensor network, mobile phones, where you want to perform such encryption, decryption. So this is the graph which is showing that the time required to break the particular key size. So time instructions per second. So if you see that, suppose I am having this much time, then what will be the key size to break? So the key size to break ECC is less than the key size to break RSA and D. The security level is offered by the less key size of RSA than compared to the, to offer the security level, the ECC requires less size than the RSA and the digital signature algorithm. and that is why ECC is widely used. So, but some issues are there. As we know that there is polar draw method, which takes around under root pi n by 2 steps, where a step is a elliptic curve addition. So if I'm using the 160 bit key, so it will require 2^8. So it will require the 9.6 × 10^11 million instructions per second years. So even though if I'm using this 160 bit curve, it requires this much time. And that is a software based attack, and this much computational power is difficult to produce or difficult to apply. Hardware attacks you can also perform. You can build a hardware for parallel search using the polar draw method. So through polar draw method, you can perform the parallel search, but still it is very difficult. And so we can say that ECC is providing the sufficient level of security. Why this is called a sufficient level security? Because within a given computational power, it is difficult to break it. But tomorrow, if highly high computing task or highly computing computers will come, like say the quantum computers, this security of elliptic curve will be broken. And that is why researchers are now moving forward the quantum resistance cryptography. Because you know that security and attacks are kind of like race between the attackers and security researchers. So today, if you are coming with the solution with the given computational power, tomorrow it can be broken by developing more computational power. So now, so we have already seen that how elliptic curve is used to generate the wallet addresses, and elliptic curve digital signature algorithm is used for transaction initiation and broadcasting so that non-repudiation and transaction authentication can be achieved. How hashing can be seen? So encoding wallet address, we have seen that for that hashing is also required. Encode the transaction between the wallets, for that also hash function is required. And verifying and validating the account balancing, for that hash is required. And mining or proof of work, we'll see later, for that also hashing is required. What is hash function? First of all, we'll see all these things, that how hash is going to be used to perform these four tasks. But before that, we'll see hash in the detail. So you know that encryption is providing the confidentiality, like this. Alice is sending the encrypted message to the Bob. The question is, the attacker, which is like you, whether this you can do anything to this data. So you is not able to read this data, but you can modify this data. So if you is modifying this data, means I am sending message to the Bob. If this message is replaced and if it is sent to the Bob, even though if it is encrypted, the modified encrypted message will go to the Bob. So how can Bob tell if Alice's message was modified? So for that, we can use the hash function to offer the integrity of data. Means the whatever data are sent by the Alice, same data should be received by Bob, and that is provided by the hash function. Like hash tables were used in for the data searches. So whatever data you have, you apply the hash function and corresponding index you can find out into the database. So hash function should take the variable size input. Data can be of any size, but it will produce the fixed size output. Generally, this output size will be less than the input size. And that is why hash functions are called as compression functions also. Compute. And it should be pseudo random so that it distributes uniformly over the table. So if I'm having the different kinds of data, the hash should be distributed over this table. Means two same data should not have same hash value. Sorry, I'm getting some interruption. Yeah. So in security, AIC is using variety of applications, but not the same as async used into the DB or CRC checking, CRC. Like given any S value, it should be computationally infeasible to find any X such that HX is equal to the given that value. Means target S value is difficult to find out. So suppose if I'm having the target S value, for me it should be very difficult or infeasible to find out a given message X, such that if I will apply that S function over that X, I will achieve the edge. And this is showing the one-wayness of the S function. Means your S function should be in such a way that from a given message, it should be easy to find out the X. It should be easy to find out the X. But from a given S value, it should be very difficult to find out that given X. And that is the one-wayness. Now, second property, for a given X, it should be computationally infeasible to find out the Y such that the S of this H will be equal. That means, even if I am having two different values of X and Y, I should not be able to find out, or I should not be able to derive the S of H, X and S of Y will be equal. This is called as weak collision resistance. Third property saying that it should be computationally infeasible to find out any two values, X and Y. These two values, X and Y, should be different, such that HX is equal to XY, and that is called as strong collision resistance. So whatever function you are using for generating the S value, it should follow these three properties so that it can be used into the cryptography. So if you see here, this first property is relevant to the mining a block. Means from a given block, it is easy to calculate the hash value, but we have to generate the hash value as the target value, and that is computationally infeasible. So in a blockchain, they are not strict to find out the hash value of a generated block to a particular value, but they are strict to the what? The calculating the S value of a given block should be lower than the previous block S value. And that can be achieved by doing the trial error method. So like for example, that S512S function takes for input message up to length 2^128 bit, but generates the output 512 bit. So it can be called as message digest. The S value is called as message digest. And it can be considered as a compression function, where SAS stands for the secure S algorithm. So we can think of S code as a fixed size fingerprint of the variable size. So now further topics, I will start at 4 o'clock. I think you have break for 30 minutes, 3:30 to 4 o'clock.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so okay. I'll start at 4 o'clock. Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
And I'll take questions at the end of next session.
Okay, sir. Okay. Fine. Use the same link for joining the session at 4 p.m.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you.
अर्धो अर्धो कलाक ब्रेक. रेकॉर्डिंग चालू रेकॉर्डिंग चालू तो करो रेकॉर्डिंग बंद कर दो ना अत्यारे रेकॉर्डिंग बंद कर दो.